So what is up YouTube, welcome back to the channel once again. You know I appreciate having you here. Now today's video, well it's been brought to my attention and that's why I'm doing today's video, is I haven't done a review on my own bike. I purchased this bike way back when, last year, and I did all the reviews leading up to this bike, but I've never actually done one on this bike. So stick around for today's video because it's all about this thing. Thanks for sticking around, really appreciate it. And it's actually a review this time. I usually do first impressions because you can't do a review on a bike you just take out for a test ride. It's almost impossible. But I've had this for over 1,000 miles. I've also had the predecessor to this, the other CB500X. And that's one of the reasons I bought this one, because I like that bike so much. I went back and dipped my toe back in that CB500 water. And that basically says a lot about the bike, because this is the first bike that I've actually gone back and bought the same model again, even though this one's slightly updated. I am going to give you a walk round at the end of the video and give you some details on the bike, but before I do that I want to tell you what I like about the bike, what I don't really like about the bike, and how I get on with it. Well, the most obvious reason is for days like this, commuting like this, stop start traffic. I mean, it's 3 o'clock in the afternoon, the clock's wrong, but it's 3 o'clock in the afternoon. So it's school kicking out time, or the mothers and fathers are on their way to pick up their lovely little cherished ones from school. So it means it's crazy time. A lot of traffic, not a lot of people looking. And this bike's pretty good for just plodding around in this sort of traffic. It's nice and slim, it's nice and light. I mean, it's not like off-road 250 light, but it's lighter than a tank. Definitely lighter than the tank, so it's quite handy for nipping about, cutting through traffic, lane splitting, that sort of thing, because it's quite thin. I mean, it would benefit from wider bars for maneuverability, but it's kind of a commuter, so the bars need to be thin to make it manageable through traffic. Handling wise, she's okay. She's not exceptional, but she's okay. I quite like it. You get quite a bit of feel from it, even though it's got budget suspension. It's got a little bit of adjustment on the front and a little bit on the back, but the springs are not that great. They're a bit soft. They suit me. I like a comfortable bike when I'm using it for everyday stuff. Maneuverability wise, it's not going to be as quick steering as say the 500F, because that's a lot lower down, whereas going from side to side you've got a lot more top heavy weight to push from one side to the other. Although saying that, it's not really that top heavy, it is quite well balanced. Brakes on it are pretty good. You've got ABS on the front and rear. You cannot switch it off. Not that I want to, because this is a commuter, this is my city bike basically, this is my everyday go-to bike, and I quite like the fact that I've got ABS. It's worked out quite nicely on occasions when people just drive out in front of you. It can come in quite handy, gives you that little bit of a safety net. So comfort wise is not too bad. The seat's soft, but maybe just a tiny little bit too soft. That's probably down to me. I mean, I'm 16 stone, well just over 16 stone, 6'2". So I'm not a small person, so I'm probably compressing it more than the average rider. But it's good for about 100 miles before you start getting that uncomfortable that you've got to think about slapping your ass cheeks to wake them up again. But you've got to remember, everything on this bike is built down to a price. That's why this bike, in my opinion, is one of the best value commuters stroke adventure motorcycles on the market. I mean, I wouldn't quite put this in the adventure category, although it's got adventure styling. That's more of what it is, adventure styling. I'd put it in more of the commuter market. It's definitely a commuter bike, maybe with a little bit of adventure. There are companies out there where you can pay to change the suspension, the tires, the wheels, and everything else to make it more off-road, and then yeah, it's an adventure bike. But at the moment I'd say street commuter bike. Right, let's see what she's like. I don't know what gear I'm in, because that's one of the problems with this. It's got no gear indicator, and once you use a bike with gear indicators you tend to like them. Right, I'm sitting here at 70 and it's a little bit buzzy. It's not too bad, but it's a little bit buzzy. If I remember correctly from my old bike, because this is exactly the same engine, 60 really smooth, and around 80 was not too bad, but that 70 mile an hour mark, it was a bit buzzy, and it is on this. And that's why you've got massive amounts of rubber on the foot pegs to absorb some of that vibration. You don't tend to get it through the bars, just through the foot pegs, and it is eliminated by the amount of rubber you've got on the foot pegs, so you don't feel it too much. I mean, you know it's there, but it's not intrusive. When I do the walk round of the bike, I will go over the clocks and what's on there and switch gear and all the bits that I've added to it to make it more comfortable for myself. But this bit is mainly just about the ride, and I have to say this bike is fun. Now please don't get confused between excitement and fun. They're two different things. Journalists will make you believe you can only have fun if the bike's exciting, which usually means lots and lots of power. This bike doesn't have a lot of power, and it's designed for just plodding around. It's not for wheeling, it's not a stunt machine, it's not a sports bike. It's literally an everyday bike, something you can take out in rain, shine, snow. You don't care really, you just get on it and you go. So in a way, yeah, I suppose it is an adventure bike. So I'll take back what I said earlier, I will give it, it's an adventure bike. It's a bike you probably would take on a few trips as well. And you wouldn't mind if it sort of like got a little bit scuffed up. And that's a good thing about this bike. Kind of part of the reason I bought it is one, I've had this before. I had the older model of this and it was a great bike, but I sold it to buy a 700 Tracer Yamaha, and I felt that was a mistake. That was a big mistake. The Yamaha Tracer wasn't a better bike. It was faster, louder, handled better, but it didn't really make me feel that much better on it. Whereas this feels better as an all-rounder. I know that's a bold statement because the Tracer is a fantastic bike, but I just preferred this for ease of use. It's one of those bikes that when it's pissing down with rain and you come out from work and you think, oh, I've got to ride home, my clothes are still damp for the morning, just get on, start the engine, put it in first gear, off you go. No problems, no hassles. And that's what this bike is. It's a no-hassle, easy bike. Don't get me wrong, if you're in the market for thrills and excitement, don't get this bike. Do not get this bike. But if you're in the market for something that's reliable, dependable, will go for miles on a single tank, I get around 200 miles to this tank, about 190 miles the light will come on, and I fill it up then. So anywhere between 180 and 200 miles the light comes on for the reserve, but that'll probably give me another 40 miles in the tank as well, so it will go on for miles. My Africa Twin only does 160 miles till the light comes on, and that is a pure adventure bike, whereas this, as I said, I class it as a commuter, but this will do over 200 miles quite easily on a tank. So all in all, would I recommend this bike? Yes, I would, 100%, but it does depend on what you're in the market for. I mean, there's no greater testament than the fact that this is the second one I've bought. Granted, it's the newer model than the one I had before, and the updates they've done on this are really, really good. It was cheap to buy. It's not cheap in the sense that it's peanuts. It's cheap for a new bike and for what it does. If you want a budget all-rounder and you've got around $5,000 to spend, this is a really, really good buy. It's dependable. I mean, it's Honda. It's not going to break really, is it? I've had 5 Hondas and I've never had a single thing go wrong with any of them. Image wise, you're not going to be the coolest kid on the block, but you've got to accept that it's a commuter, and that is another good thing about riding this around London. You can leave it places and you don't have that kind of worry that it's going to get stolen. I mean, if you put a Vespa next to this, the little will steal the Vespa every time over this. This kind of flies under the radar, and that's another reason why I bought this. So if you're in and around London, I'm not saying it's not going to get nicked, it might do, but there's less chance of this getting stolen than there is something that's a little bit flash and sticks out. So what I'm going to do now is I'm going to find a space to pull over and give you a little walk round of the bike, take you through some details of it, and show you some of the modifications I've done to it since I've had it. So I shall see you in a little while. Well, hello. This is a bit more relaxing. Let me take you over the bike, show you around it. Don't worry, I'm not squidding. This is my garden. I mowed the lawn yesterday, so I might as well make use of it. Let's go front to back. It is a little bit dirty at the moment. You'll have to forgive me for that. It was raining on the way to work this morning. Now glorious sunshine, but this is the UK. 120 70 17 on the front, and these are Dunlop, what are they, Trailmax D609Fs. Really good in the dry, but for some reason in the wet I haven't got much confidence in them. That may be just me rather than the tire, but the tire that was on my old CB500, I think it was a Pirelli, seemed to have much more feel in the wet, whereas this one, not 100% confident, but in the dry pretty good. It's also got a Seeing as we're on the tyres, we might as well do this one. That is a 160/60/17, and pretty good. As you can see, not all the way over, but I'm pretty close to the edge, a few mils off, which is not bad for this type of bike. Right, from the front, it's a lot more angular than it was on the last model. Last model was a bit softer. This is a bit more, I suppose, transformer-ish. It looks like a transformer to me, especially this bit here. But it's a bit sharper with the looks. Indicators are still the same as they were on the last model, these Shrek's ear type things. But they're pretty good in the fact that they take a knock and they're pretty robust. Let me turn the lights on for you, because this year, or say this model, is now probably not going to be able to see this. I'm not sure. I don't know if you can see that or not. Hopefully you can. But this year you've got LEDs, and you've got LEDs on the front. And I know I said I was going front to back. I lied. What are you going to do? Yeah, as you can see, LEDs on the back. Indicators are the same as the front, both bulbs and Shrek's ears, but pretty robust if it does fall over. I think they'll take a bit of a hit. My last one got scuffed to bits, and they were pretty good. So I can vouch for those. If you want to change them to LEDs, feel free. Right, let's go through the dash. You've got a little button here, which is select, and one here for set. Select will run you through trip A, trip B. Miles per gallon, that's what I've got it set on. I think you can do kilometers per gallon or miles per liter or whatever you want to do. Average miles per gallon, I'm averaging 67.5 miles to the gallon at the moment. That's not bad. I haven't touched this since I've bought the bike, so that's a true representation of 848 miles. The only other information you've got on here is a clock. Got a fuel gauge here, rev counter and speedo. That's it. Nothing more glorious than that. You've got idiot lights, neutral, oil, ABS, which goes off at 5 miles an hour. But not much more than that. I would like to see a gear indicator on one of these, seeing as it's marketed as a beginner bike or commuter bike. So a gear indicator is always handy. And seeing as it is kind of in the adventure style market, and I think this should be standard on all bikes actually, is a range. I'd like to see range on all bikes. I like to know how many miles roughly I've got left in a tank. It also comes standard with his Honda ignition security system. Exciting stuff, I know, but what can you do? Comes standard with this screen, which is better than the previous model. The previous model had like a little sports type screen on the front, which was absolutely useless. This is a little bit better, even though I've got an extension on it, because I am 6'2". It's also on its highest settings. It's got two settings. This is the highest. It only drops down probably to sit on that line there. So that's how much space you've got. It'll only come up and down that sort of level. Right, the forks are just standard forks. They're just normal forks, everyday forks. Nothing fancy. A little bit of adjustment on them, but not too much. And also at the front, you've got single brake disc with ABS. If you ever see a bike with this little ring on the inside, no matter how big it is, it's got these little dents. That denotes it's ABS. And just in case you didn't believe me, it's written there as well. I do like these wheels, though they need a clean. I don't know what it is about the CB500 wheels, but I really like them. I like the finish on them. They're pretty good quality for a budget bike. Brakes, Nissin calipers at front, Nissin calipers at back. They stop you, and the ABS works. What more do you need to know? Right, engine-wise, 500cc. It's less than that. It is actually this. But they round it up to make it sound better. It's, I wouldn't say gutless, but it's not gonna sort of like grab you by the cojones and say, come on, let's just go and challenge Rossi. It's not going to do that. It's just going to say, yeah, let's go. But quite sedately, and let's just chill. That's what it is, basically. Chilled out engine. Right, tank. As I said, it's pretty good. A range of about, I'd say about 240 at a push. I'm filling it up 180 to 200, depending on my style of riding, what I'm doing. As soon as the countdown comes on here, it's not a light. I think it has got a petrol light, I'm not sure, I can't even remember. But it starts to count down literage, or count up literage, until you've got 0.5. It's a weird thing. I'd rather have a normal range thing on there, but it hasn't got that. But you get used to it. It's quite simple to follow. Seat's pretty comfortable, not the greatest. It's got this anti-slip surface on, which is pretty good, so you don't slide around all over the place. I say about 100 miles, and then you're probably looking to walk around a little bit. But it's not too bad. It's a bit low for me. I'd prefer it around here. You can get aftermarket seats. I'm not going to bother, but you could. Let's have a little look under the seat. No one ever shows people under the seats on reviews. Why is that? So just a key down there, clips up, slightly back, and there you go, under the seat. I keep a puncture repair kit under there, but that's the only space you got. Not a lot really, but enough for a puncture repair kit, and that's all that matters. I suppose you could keep some other stuff under there. I don't know what. It wouldn't fit a lock, I wouldn't have thought. Right, let's go through some of the modifications I've done from front to back. Screen is the obvious one. I put this little extender on it. It was only a £20 job from eBay, but it breaks the wind up nicely. I get no buffeting whatsoever around the crash helmet. As you can hear when I'm filming, when I'm on the go, you don't get any of that wind rush, or not too much of it. It breaks it up nicely, so I don't get sort of like hammered in the face like when I've got this screen on its own. It just sort of like hits me straight in the visor. Also put on the hand guards. These are Jivvy ones, just simple ones. They don't really do anything. They just keep the rain and the weather off. They've got no protection in here. They're not like what's the other one, Barkbusters, when they've got the metal strip in here. So they're not designed to smash things out the way. They're just designed to keep the weather off. Also got Oxford heated grips that are pretty good, better than the Honda ones, have to admit that. And a 12 volt power charger, so I can power my schnizzles on the way. I've also got the rear luggage on this. I've got the back box, which is a Jivvy Trekker, I believe. Yeah, Trekker Outback. I've had this for ages, ever since my last CB500. I also use it on my Africa Twin. I just interchange between the two because it's quite handy. Some of you have asked what this is for. This is for hanging my waterproof trousers on when I get caught short at the side of the road. It stops me sort of like falling around. I could just hang stuff on there, and it's quite handy. Obvious one is the exhaust, Delcovic exhaust. It's only from there to there, so it's not a whole system, it's just a slip-on. Nice and easy to fit, sounds reasonable. The engine's not that loud, it hasn't got that far in order where it sounds like a V-twin. It actually sounds like a parallel twin, so it's a little bit quieter, which sometimes is a good thing. It's a nice little exhaust, very cheap. The only problem with this is the baffle goes in this end, which I find strange. So if I want to put the baffle back in, I've got to take this off and put the baffle back in. Weird. Oh, while I'm down here, these are the rubber foot pegs. These are the ones that are designed to sort of like absorb all the vibration. The only problem with these is if you've got boots with no grip on, as in they're not like off-road boots with chunky grips on, when these are wet and your boots are wet, your feet slide all over the place. I'd rather they be like the Africa Twin, because the Africa Twin's got the rubber bit in the middle, but it's also got the serrated edge around the outside, so if you're putting pressure on, they grip a little bit better. What else have I done? Oh, the obvious crash bars, Jivvy crash bars, and these are really good just in case you sort of like fall over. They'll protect it a little bit, and also I like putting my feet on them. Let me show you. When I'm riding along and cruising, I just stick my feet up there, like that. And there you go. It's a cruiser as well. What a fantastic bike. So that's my Honda CB500X. Sorry I haven't done a review earlier. I totally forgot to do one, to be honest. But I've done one now, and there it is. If you've got any questions, leave them in the comments section below. You know I'm always going to get back to decent questions, or sensible questions. I know they're not all going to be sensible. They never are. So whatever your question is, leave it in the comment section below. And it just leaves me to wrap this video up. Thank you very much for watching. Really appreciate it. Don't forget to subscribe, to like, to share, to do all those things that you need to do. Because if you do not, the CB500 is going to come around and slap the f*** out of you. Anyway, you know I love you all. Stay safe. Fish out. I never did you wrong, but you did me wrong, so go ahead, get gone. Get all your bags, get out my house, I don't want your stuff around. I never did you wrong, but you did me wrong, so go ahead and get gone.